things that obviously these sessions will be doing is helping the different spirits in all sorts of various locations in the spirit world to work through their emotional issues and progress. And many of you will have that role of helping them. Of course, to help them, you need to have firstly helped yourself through that same emotion generally. So that's one of the things we'll be talking about. A few sort of housekeeping things first. Some of you, this may be the first session you've ever been to. If it is, there was a session that was done around, I think it would have been about 6 weeks ago now, called Spirit Relationships, the Laws of Rapport and Spirit Communication. And I think it's now on DVD, the Spirit Communication DVD. And my suggestion is that if you haven't seen that session, that you actually watch it. The reason why is that all of these sessions that I'm planning to develop people's mediumship skills and also their healing skills will all be based around information that I presented in that discussion. So that discussion is really like an overview, if you like, of all of the things that you're going to be presented from now on in terms of developing your mediumship skills and developing your healing skills. And it's a three-page handout that comes with that as well. So what I've recently done, just tonight actually, is sent to Peter and to James a copy of this handout, the Spirit Communication handout. And that, so that should be in your email if you've given an email address over the coming day or so. It might even be there now if it's come from James. If it's come from Peter, it won't be there probably till tomorrow. I'll just turn this down a little. I've sent a second handout too on that same email. And we might change this into a rock course. The handout is entitled Mediumship and Healing, Session 1, Introduction, Truths and Soul Condition. Now, what I'll be doing with every single session with regard to these mediumship sessions will be handing out a handout which is basically a very brief outline of what we discuss and also your homework for the month. So one of the things that I would like to encourage you to do, if you're really passionate about your mediumship and developing mediumship skills, and particularly if you're already a medium, you already know you have some spirit communication skills, or you're already a healer and you know that you have certain intuition with healing, what I would really like to encourage you to do is to now develop those skills by using some of these techniques. And they are not going to be techniques that are metaphysical in nature or physical in nature. So they won't be techniques surrounding things like meditation or any of those kind of techniques. They're going to be techniques that focus on your soul condition. Now, for many of you, you've been to a session about where I've talked about the soul and talked about what soul condition is. And that's one of the things that is very important for you to focus on during these sessions. So I'll be these handouts will happen with each session. And basically what I'm doing with these handouts is sort of exploding, if you like, some of the details that are in this spirit communication handout. So in other words, the spirit communication handout and the spirit communication talk that we did for 4 hours was like an introduction to spirit communication. And then this will be like the month-by-month lessons, if you like, that you can work through different lessons with regard to spirit communication and healing. The other thing I'd like to encourage you to do is to think about what your passion and longing is. Like, so if you're here just for the sake of sort of developing, you're interested in developing spirit communication and you don't already have spirit communication, what will happen is these sessions will certainly assist you to develop it, but you may take a lot longer to develop than for those who have already been receiving messages and have already got some natural, if you like, some natural communication skills. And my focus really and aim with all of these things is to help all of you start allowing yourself to see communication with the spirit world as a seamless thing. Something that happens on a minute by minute, hour by hour basis. Not something that you have to actually choose a certain time to do, but rather something that can happen all the time. And after a while, you'll start seeing spirit friends as just friends. You won't see them as anything different than any other friend you have here on earth, for example. And that, in the end, is actually to be able to start channeling some really important divine truths, which are only available from the celestial spheres, which is the eighth sphere upwards. And once that information can be channeled to the earth, then a lot of changes can occur on the earth as a result of that information. Now, some of that information is very much, and most of the information is very much surrounding the area of divine truth and divine love. But other bits of the information are to do with things like scientific discoveries that are yet to be given to the earth, and medical discoveries that are yet to be given to the earth, and so forth. So many of you will have this part to play, if you like. You'll come to see this part that you will play in receiving truths that have never been received before. So that will be quite interesting if you allow that to occur. Now, this is going to happen over a period of a year or so. So none of this is going to be like a quick fix. I'm not going to give you some things tonight and all of a sudden, whammo, you have everything happening and all of a sudden you know how to develop yourself and you know how to communicate with spirits at a high level. Because spirit communication is totally dependent upon your soul condition. Does that make sense? So it's your soul condition that this is very dependent upon. Now, because of that, I'd like to give you a few examples. I was talking to, in the time over the last 5 years, I've had the chance on occasion to visit some mediums. Many of these mediums that I've visited have been people that have been mediums for maybe 30 to 50 years. So they've been mediums for a long, long time, communicating with what they believe to be a range of developed spirits. And this particular medium that I would like to tell you about was one medium that I met around about 5 years ago. And the very first meeting was interesting because she was in a very humble place, this medium, and because of that, she was able to actually listen to and hear some relayed celestial spirit messages. So what happens with a celestial spirit, if a medium can't hear a message, what a celestial spirit does is they talk to another spirit, and who talks then to another spirit, who then talks to another spirit who happens to be the guide of the medium. And then the medium talks to the person. And this happens all the time, and a lot of people are not aware that that's going on. And the reason why the first spirit, the celestial spirit, can't talk to the person on earth is because the person on earth's condition is not good enough to sustain a conversation with them. And so what they do is they have these relayed messages to earth. And this obviously has its problems, because one of the problems is if you relay a message, each person puts their own emotional inflections and their own belief system upon the message. Now, this was what was happening to this lady, and I could feel that this was what was happening. And so over a period of the next couple of years, I visited her twice more because I was very interested in her as a person. And in the last visit to her, I actually asked whether I could talk to her guide. And then I asked her guide what sphere she was in. And her answer was, I'll just give you some of her answers and write them down. She said, I'm in the 19th sphere. And then she tried to convince me that it didn't matter anyway what sphere she was in. And then we began talking a bit more and a bit more and so forth. And I started talking to her about her emotions. So I'm talking through the medium to her own guide, who has been her guide for 30 years. Now, this medium believed her guide was one of the highest possible spirits she could ever communicate to. Once I started talking to the medium, the spirit, about her emotions, because I could feel her emotions and what they were about, the spirit started crying. And then I asked her to that I had a celestial spirit with me who could tell her what sphere she actually existed in. And the celestial spirit told her the sphere that she was in, and have a guess what it was. No, it was actually the second. Yeah. So this lady, who had been communicating with her guide, which actually, by the way, was not her guide, but this lady who's been connected to her guide for 30-something years and believed this person to be her guide and believed her to be a very highly developed spirit, actually, in this one moment, found out actually that her guide was in the second sphere. Now, we were talking for about 15 or 20 minutes, and her guide, her spirit guide, just began crying and sobbing about the subject we were talking about, which was some of the emotions that she'd gathered while she was on Earth that she had not yet released. And what happened then was the guide realized that her development, so her guide actually felt that she was in this place. So her guide actually felt, her spirit guide felt, that the spirit guide was actually in a place of high development. And the lady on Earth, of course, the medium, also felt that her spirit guide was of high development. And then in one little conversation with this very maniacal person, AJ, she found out actually that the spirit guide found out she was in the second sphere, and the medium on Earth also found out that her spirit guide was in the second sphere. And not only that, her spirit guide was now crying so much that she couldn't speak with her anymore. And I rang her up about 4 to 5 days later, and I asked her whether her spirit guide had stopped crying yet. And she hadn't stopped crying yet. So she'd cried solidly from the time that I spoke with her for the next 4 or 5 days. And by this time, the medium, the lady on Earth, whose guide, if I can put the guide in quotation marks, whose guide this spirit was getting quite upset with me, because she felt that I had destroyed the relationship between her and her guide. And she started feeling that I was some kind of evil megalomaniac or something. I don't know. What does megalomaniac mean again? Power tripping. Big maniac. And she started projecting those emotions at me of anger. So from that time on, I've never seen that medium. But I do know how her guide is doing. And ironically, her guide is now on the divine love path and in the celestial spheres of the spirit world, but cannot communicate with that medium anymore, because the medium has not changed her own condition. So that's just a little story about what happens in terms of what's going on in the spirit world. I went to visit another medium, and she was in a very similar state to the first medium. Really lovely ladies, both of these. But again, had the skill of communication to spirit right from an early age. From 3 years of age, she can remember talking to spirits all of her life. When I met her, she was in her 50s, late 50s, and unfortunately, because of the types of spirits that she was associating with, quite often was drunk in the afternoons. So she'd have very, very clear communication in the mornings, and in the afternoons it had a tendency to wobble off into obscurity because of the spirits that were connected to her. And again, we had the same issue of relayed messages down, but this time I could not connect with her guides because her guides refused to have a conversation with me. A friend of mine, who is the Apostle John, who, when he was on Earth, before he passed, he went to visit a medium. And this medium told him that her guides were the Archangel Gabriel and the Archangel Michael. Now, John knew that wasn't the case. And so he started asking not the medium, but the medium's guides questions. And the very standard answer that he got right across the board was, "You are not meant to ask us questions. We are here to tell you." Now, what does that tell you about their condition? It has to be a pretty low condition. Does that make sense? But she herself, the medium, couldn't see that. And so after John left, she went around with a smudge stick to get away, to get John's energy out of the place. But in reality, she was connecting to spirits in the first sphere who were impersonating other spirits because they could, and they could get away with it. Now, there was another time what happened after John passed. So John passed in, I think it was late 2000, just early 2007. And he had a very, very close friend. And she was very close to John for the previous 6 months. Now, John was a gay man, but she was a woman who was quite interested in John as a partner. And it took John quite a bit of convincing of her to get her to realise that, in fact, he said, I'm a gay man, and we won't ever be able to have this relationship that you want. But John then passed. And so he's in the spirit world now, and this is a few months down the track of him being in the spirit world. He's in quite a good condition. He's worked through some of his emotions after passing, and he's in quite good condition. So she decides that she's missing him so badly that she wants to communicate with him. And so she sits down at the computer, and she starts getting words, like automatic writing. So, and have any of you done automatic writing? So quite a few of you would have done some automatic writing. So she starts, but this time, typing as she's going the message. And who is this? The Apostle John is the answer. And, you know, how are you doing? Oh, I'm doing really good. I'm doing fantastic. Everything's going really good. Now, what happened in this conversation was that the lady in question just started opening herself up to who this person was, who she believed was the Apostle John. And as it turned out later, she opened herself up so much that there was a bit of sexual interaction that went on, in fact, between her and the spirit. And then on top of that, there was a number of different messages that he gave her that were obviously, like I knew John well enough, and she didn't realise, even though she knew John quite well, that this wasn't John. So what happened after a little bit of time and a bit of discussion, I said to her, look, you know, this isn't John. Who do you think it is? And as soon as she allowed herself to consider that it wasn't John, she knew instantly who it was. And it was a man who was interested in her before he died and who suicided. And he came to her because she was open to communicating with spirits, and he decided that he would just claim to be the person she wanted to talk to. And so he just went straight in and talked to her. Now, the interesting thing is she said, but I prayed to God to only receive from the Apostle John. So why didn't I just receive from the Apostle John? And the answer is that her soul condition was such that she was willing to receive from anybody who would tell her what she wanted to hear. And she was actually avoiding this deep grief that she had about the Apostle John's death. And that was the reason why she was talking to him and receiving a message. But the message wasn't from the person who she was thinking it was. And you know what surprises me so much out of all of these things? Is how much we can believe somebody who talks to us from spirit without any validation whatsoever. And yet, how much we also don't trust the person next door talking to us at the same time. And I've seen over and over and over these times where people are just talking to spirits who they believe is a certain type of spirit, or they believe is a certain person, and in reality that person is just not there at all. Somebody else is there impersonating them. So it is the collective condition of every single person in your audience that determines what spirits are going to be attracted to speak with. So in this audience, for example, many of you are seeking divine truth, seeking divine love, you're seeking God. That is going to change what type of spirits are going to be attracted to talk to you. Now, if many of you were people who just wanted to go along to a seance and just have a bit of a tire kick at the whole idea of spirit communication, and you wanted to have this, you know, just this enjoyment of asking questions and knowing answers about what's going to happen to your day tomorrow and all of those kind of things, what kind of spirits do you think you're going to attract then? Well, they're going to be spirits who are interested in those same things, are they not? So, what kind of spirit would be interested in things of the earth still?
Earthbound.
Usually earthbound spirits who are still interested in what's going on here on earth because they have yet to connect with what's happening with them in the spirit world. So the majority of times you go along to something like a seance or something like a medium, there's just surrounding that person literally hundreds of spirits who are wanting to connect to people on earth because they can't connect to people in the spirit world yet because of what they have yet to accept. Now, there is a beautiful thing about that. There's a beautiful advantages about that, and that is that every one of those spirits can be assisted if you know their condition. But how do you know their condition? The only way for you to know their condition is to know your own condition. And the problem is that the majority of us do not know our own condition. And so therefore, we don't know what spirits are attracted to us to talk to, and therefore, we're talking to spirits often that are much, much lower in condition than what we're aware of. And because of that, and because we trust them, they have a great influence in our lives. And this is the area of potential danger for development of mediumship and healing. That is, if you want to do this for some reason that is out of harmony with love, you are going to attract spirits that are out of harmony with love. And by the way, you can spend this whole year doing it to attract spirits because you want to do it out of love, and then in a year's time you get so good at it that you now start wanting to ask money for it. And you know what that's going to instantly do? Attract a whole different groups of spirits to you. Why? Because people, spirits that are interested in money are in totally different condition than what you'll be. So the problem with mediumship here on earth is that you can actually decline in your ability to communicate to spirits of a high nature, as well as grow in your ability. It just depends on what motives you have. So if you start this off, and usually when we start things in a very humble way, don't we, generally? So when we start, we often feel quite humble, quite open to learning, quite open to being taught. We feel quite inclined to listen to other people's ideas and other people's influence and everything. But as we go along in time, we get to a point often where we are now so good at what we're doing that other people are now coming to us for advice. And other people are now coming to us to get help. And in that state, we now can quite easily find ourselves declining in our spiritual condition if we're not careful. In particular, if we have any unhealed emotions within ourselves. Now, the unhealed emotions that you are going to be particularly need to be wary of is an unhealed emotion of a need for glory. This is one of the biggest reasons why mediums on earth decline in their condition. Initially, when they start in a really humble place, desirous of learning. They listen to their spirit guide. They listen to what's being said to them. They try to apply it. They work through some emotions to do that. But after a while, they become so proud of themselves. Because you imagine it. Many of you at some time in the future will be able to sit up here and actually any single person in the audience, you'll be able to tell them what emotions they have left unhealed within them. Right? Now, it won't be you knowing their emotions necessarily. It'll be your spirit guide, who's in a really, really good condition, maybe in the celestial spheres, knowing their emotions. And all he's doing is telling you. This is their emotion, this is their emotion. Oh, by the way, last week, remember you dealt with this emotion and you had this particular experience? And you're going to blow away people with that, aren't you? What do people start doing then? They start going, like, don't they then? There's this natural sort of thing that goes on with people. Now, what are you going to do with that? Are you going to repel that, keep that away from you? Are you going to deal with any emotions inside of you that have the need for glory? Or are you going to succumb to that emotion? Another one that often guides So you start off with this and you start developing your mediumship and you start working through different things, and as you get better, you get in more demand. What's the main way in the world to manage demand?
Charge
more. Right? Now, I'm going to confront the ethics of charging anything in you when it comes to mediumship during these sessions. Okay, so, but if I decide I'm going to charge more and charge more, and so it's just the elite who have lots of the dollars that can come to me to hear the so-called truths that I'm giving them, then straight away I'm not dealing with the fact of my own lack of abundance, because in the end, if I felt abundant in my life, I wouldn't need to charge for it. Now, the need for money is driven by an underlying feeling that God's not looking after me, and that's driven by underlying emotions from my childhood that I need to work through. But let's say I don't work through them. I could then become so seduced by where I'm at that I then start putting up prices. Now, what's that going to do? Is the truth now available to everybody?
No,
it's only available to the people who can pay you for it. Do you think that's a fair thing? Do you think a celestial spirit who's interested in everybody the same, including a person in Africa as a person here and a person anywhere in the world, do you think he would be party to that? So what kind of a spirit are you going to encourage when you start doing this? You're going to start encouraging a spirit on the natural love path who believes that the law of attraction means that if a person's got money, they're in better condition. And that's not true, because that's actually not defining the law of attraction correctly. Because the truth is, on the earth today, the people in countries that are in the worst condition, from a financial perspective, are being raped by the people that are in the best condition, so-called best condition. So in other words, the countries with wealth are raping these countries that have no wealth. That's how the countries got wealthy, right? So what do you think the people in the countries, condition-wise, from God's perspective is? Obviously very different to what we might then justify using the law of attraction. So the need for money then can drive us to do things that are out of harmony with love. And as soon as that happens, the kind of spirits we're going to attract are not the ones that are going to be in harmony with divine love. They're going to be in harmony with natural love. So that's not the kind of spirits that I want to encourage you to connect to. Although, I'd love you to connect to them if you're going to help them get on the divine love path. Right? And many of them will love to connect to you too, for the same purpose. But can you see, like, we could list like hundreds of emotions, in fact, that will influence how well your mediumship goes over the coming year. So one of the lessons that we'll be doing is we'll be going through your soul condition. And this mediumship session stuff that we'll be doing for the next year will be very confronting for you. And in fact, it's going to be the most confronting for those who are established mediums. Right? Now, it's going to be confronting if you allow it to be. So if you allow yourself to be challenged, and you allow yourself to work through the emotional issues, and you allow yourself to see the differences in what's going on, you'll have a large benefit from these sessions. But, conversely, if what you decide to do is to shut yourself down and get angry with me, then, well, from our course tomorrow, you will see that I probably won't allow much of that. Right? And if that occurs, then what I'll be saying is, like, there's a door there and you need to use it. Because in the end, the only people that I'm interested in helping are the people who are open emotionally. Now, you don't have to agree with me. You just need to be open emotionally. Right? And part of that is going to be working through emotional issues that cause you to shut down. And you're going to find that very confronting for many of you who are developing your mediumship. It's the emotional issues in you that cause the most resistance to receiving truth. So, obviously, one of the things we'll be dealing with is emotions. So, what I've done in this session outline that you will probably get in your email is I've tried to list all of the different things that could affect you as potential dangers. One of the potential dangers is the law of attraction you will begin to have with spirits. You see, if I'm in a condition where I have an unhealed emotion within myself that I don't even know anything about, So let's say inside of me, I am normally this calm, collected fella, and in my interaction with all women, I always give to the women, and I do whatever the woman wants. Let's say that's how I am. So outward appearances is that I'm a, you know, like snag, or what is it?
Sensitive
guy. And so I have this, you know, this outward persona, if you like, that everything's fine with me in my relationship with women. But can you imagine if I've done this for 30, 40 or 50 years, and I've never let myself have an emotion of my own desire when I'm interacting with a woman? Can you imagine there probably is quite a bit of suppressed anger in there? Right? Now, that suppressed anger is going to be attracting some very, very upset men. So if I start opening my mediumship skills and opening my desire to communicate with spirits, who are probably the first type of spirits that are going to connect with me? Probably these angry men. And I'm going to say, but I'm not an angry person. I've never been an angry person. And I'm certainly not angry with women. These men are bad men, you know, and I'm getting myself all, what's AJ doing to me, you know? And we'll probably finish up going down that track of them saying, well, I started doing this and look what's happening to my life now. Like, it's getting terrible now. Like, what is AJ doing to me? Well, I'm not doing anything to you. Your law of attraction is doing something to you to expose an emotion in you that you can work on. So what you're going to need to be doing is allow yourself to be brave enough to start opening yourself up more to these kind of interactions. But that has its own issues, doesn't it? Like, what if you start opening yourself up in terms of spirit communication and the very first spirit that comes to talk to you starts telling you that you should kill yourself? What if that happens? What would you then feel? Oh, no, I'm not talking to them spirits anymore. Like, but what if we look at the law of attraction session, which we'll be doing down the track, you'll find actually what we should be doing instead. All right, they are suicidal, right? They want me to commit suicide. I must have something that's attracting this, some emotion in me. Whoa. Like, if you've never been suicidal your whole life, you think, then that's going to be quite confronting for you to realise that actually there's a law of attraction going on. Can you see that? Mm-hmm. And it will mean working through that emotionally, getting to the core of that emotional issue. So are you prepared to do that? Because that's what you will need to do if you want to progress with it. You will need to get to the core of that emotional issue. Instead, you know what most mediums do on the natural love path? They just surround themselves with this, like, white light or, you know, protective barrier, right, which prevents any of these law of attraction spirits from actually influencing them. But the core emotion inside the medium doesn't change, and so they're not going to ever connect with spirits of a higher nature. They're going to always have relayed messages. Right? So what we want in the end is for every single one of us here, at some time in the future, I believe, every single one of us here will get to a state where you'll be able to see and hear and speak to a spirit just like I'm speaking to you. So you'll be able to sit down in a room and all of the friends there will all be spirits. And you'll be just talking to them. You'll see them like we see each other now. And talking to them in the same way. That'd be pretty awesome, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
How do you get alone time? Fear number one. Like, you're not going to get alone time. See, the law of attraction is operation at all times. So the law of attraction is also operating with the spirit world. So if I'm afraid that I'm not going to get alone time, I'm going to get pestered by spirits until I actually work through that emotion. Does that make sense? So many of you will think, how many of you will find yourself quite badgered by them?
I was just wondering, like when you said you'd be able to see them, talk to them, is it through the way that you might see them, that they'd be willing to get eyes on and be able to see them?
You'll be actually be able to see their bodies. They will have bodies like you have, and you'll see them like you see me. Yeah.
Can we take to do that now?
No. No. In the past, there has been a number, but only after years and years of development. And the material on the CD that I gave you some time ago, the Robert James Lee's material, Through the Mists, The Life Elysian, and The Gate of Heaven, those three books, actually, in one of those books, it outlines a communication, and Robert James Lee's, after 30 years of development, could see the Spirit sitting in his living room. Right? Now, that doesn't have to be 30 years of development. Right? And he did lots and lots of things to do that, but it doesn't have to take that long. Right? But that's what happened to him. And he got into such good condition that he could quite accurately channel the man Afra, which was a spirit, and channel a lot of information. Those three books are really beautiful books, in my opinion, about the spirit world and the interaction between the earth and the spirit world. And they're really worth reading. And in fact, that'll be one of your homework assignments for the first month. Other dangers are that you start to feel, and I've got some of them written down here, and I'll read them out firstly. The law of attraction with your own guides will depend on your longing for truth. So what does that mean? It means that your guide is going to change dependent upon what you long for. So if you're used to having a guide that's been around you for 20 years on the natural love path, and you start longing for divine love, your guide will change. But if you, after 2 months of longing for divine love, give it all up as a bad joke, and you go back to the natural love, then your guide will change again. And you will find that your guide may even change, and you may have two different spirits with you while you're in this state of indecision. One a natural love guide and one a divine love guide. If you have an emotion coming up in you and you're a woman and you have this anger towards men and you have a natural love guide, you may get a different guide come in for a moment to help you through that emotion on the natural love path. If you're on the divine love path and you're longing for God's love, you may attract a different woman or man who will help you through that emotion. So your guides will change as you go along. So the key is to not be attached to it. The key is to allow yourself to connect to these different spirits and feel their emotions. That's what it's all about. But to feel their emotions, you have to feel your own emotions. So if I have anger with men inside of me, then obviously I'm not really going to notice a man who's angry with men come to me, am I? I'm going to think he's pretty normal. But if I have no anger with men inside of me, then a spirit who comes to me with anger with men, I am going to instantly recognise what one of their main issues are. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And therefore I can help them. And obviously they're attracted to me for a reason, so they can help me. If I look at it that way, and look at every interaction with spirit as the same as I look with an interaction with each of you, then and be humble about each of those interactions, then I'm going to constantly learn from everyone, including my spirit interactions. So this is not about, and none of this is going to ever be about, developing yourself into a state where, you know, everyone just looks up to you. Now, as a subsequent result of your development, people may look up to you, but you will not see that as an issue. You will not long for that in your heart if you work through the emotions. I've also said here that you will be very tempted not to do your own emotional work. How many of you are already very tempted not to do your own emotional work? Now, you imagine for a moment you're going along fine, right? What you believe is fine. And your law of attraction is looking good, you know, you're looking cool, everything's looking really smooth, right? And then an emotion starts bubbling up inside of you, right? In other words, you start feeling the emotion. So let's say the emotion is, oh boy, I'm really angry with my mother, right? Terrible, terrible rage with her, in fact, right? You'll be very tempted to shut that down, especially when you've got 10 spirits hanging around you at the time, all angry with their mother too, right? And you'll be very tempted to go into the place of trying to get away from that emotion rather than go into it the grief of it causally. And those spirits, if you want to get away from the emotion, they'll help you do that. Because that's your law of attraction. So many of you are going along quite smoothly at the moment, and then you met AJ, and then life just took a downhill turn from there, right? Many of you feel that. Like. Now, why did it take this downhill turn? Because you're starting to get real about your real emotional condition. You're starting to look at things that you were never looking at before. You're starting to examine emotions that you could never see before. You're starting to examine truths that you'd never conceived before. And that opens up your soul, and that opens up your law of attraction even further, and you have a soul desire to start accessing emotions in you that you never had before. Because before, most of us had a soul desire to avoid every possible emotion except the good ones, right? Like if it was sex, happy, you know, anything like that, we'll go for that. But if it's like sadness, grief, sorrow, suicidal feelings, most of us don't want to go anywhere near those, do we? And so what we do is we avoid all of this emotion that we call bad, and we embrace all of the emotion that we call good, and in the end suppress ourselves to that condition, because you won't grow from that condition if you do that. And that's what many of us have done. And then when we start connecting to our emotions, start connecting to truth, things start opening for us in every possible way. But a lot of those ways are our own emotions that we've suppressed for years and years just start coming up in us and start really affecting us, and we're starting to be overwhelmed. How many of you felt overwhelmed with your emotions and emotional processing stuff? Yeah, quite a number, right? And felt so overwhelmed that you just want to stop, right? And what I'm trying to do is encourage you, just keep going. Keep going to the bottom of them. When you get to the bottom of it, it will be gone. And once it's gone, your soul condition changes. And this, of course, applies to every spirit who is here with us too, in the room, who is still in one of the lower spheres of the spirit world. Now, these are the potential dangers you face in doing this work. And my suggestion is that over the next year, many of you will get into a very, very tight binds when it comes to these emotions. And many of you will be very, very tempted to blame me. Very tempted. Right? And my suggestion is, if you want to blame me, then you need to come along to tomorrow's session about anger, and we'll talk about blame of others in order to get away from emotions. And allow yourself to work through those things emotionally. Because if you do not, you will then stagnate your own growth. So the beauty of mediumship and the beauty of healing gifts is they can help you immensely with your own growth if you decide to open up to them. You imagine for a moment, if you've got a celestial guide and you're open to hearing this celestial guide, and you're open to hearing a critique of every emotional reason why you do everything. You imagine that. So you're walking along the road and he's saying, oh, you walked along this road because you were avoiding that road. Do you know why you were avoiding that road? Yeah, there was a dog there that comes out to bark and you get scared every time. You know, my suggestion is you walk along the road where the dog is. Right? Imagine that if this celestial spirit was talking to you like that all day and you started following some of this direction to deal with your emotion. You'd deal with emotion a lot more rapidly then, wouldn't you?
Do you have that?
Sorry?
Do you have that?
No.
I have that.
Mary has it.
There's no one helping you.
No. No. But every one of you can connect with a spirit. I don't have spirits assisting me. That's one of the guidelines I placed on them before I reincarnated. But every one of you has that option. Every one of you. So every one of you has this option of getting this constant help, right? Through your law of attraction, through these spirits. Every one of you has the option through these gifts of actually connecting to and helping people in the spirit world even. So how many of you would like to tell other people on earth about these truths? Quite a lot, right? Now, well, pretty much everyone here. How many of you have tried and found it wasn't very successful? Almost everyone that put up their hand before. But you know, there's literally millions and millions of spirits wanting this truth from you. Literally millions of them. And there's been times when I've sat down and spoken through a medium to 50,000 spirits at a time, or 100,000 spirits. now we're getting like almost a million spirits along to many of the groups who are hearing these truths, right? You have the ability to communicate to these spirits and actually help them. And they, the beauty of it is they want help. They're not like people on earth who want to ignore it all and make it all go away. They're people who have been through all of that, very, very dissatisfied, in really bad states in the spirit world, badly screaming for help, but cannot trust anybody in a higher condition than that. And they can only trust people on earth because they are the ones they connect with the best, which is one of us. And so we can relate to them. Tomorrow I'll be playing a mediumship discussion that I had with around 200 or 300 slaves, spirits, in Barbados through a medium. And the reason why I'm playing it tomorrow is it's related to the anger discussion. But you'll be able to do that to thousands and thousands and thousands of spirits in all sorts of conditions. But to do it effectively, you'll have to be able to feel their emotions. And of course that means that you're going to have to be open to your own emotions. So let's say you're a woman medium on earth and you're very angry with men. And this group of men, this group of men come along to you through your law of attraction who have abused women on earth. And they come to talk to you. Right? And you're a woman on earth who's been very angry with men because you've been abused by your father, let's say. You imagine how confronting that's going to be emotionally for both you and that group of spirits. Now, you could just choose to get into a rage, couldn't you, with them? Or you could choose to work through the issues emotionally. So all of you will have options to do different things like that. Does that make sense? So allow these things to develop within you. Now, many of the younger persons here are going to find it a lot easier than the older persons here. And the reason why is because the older we get, usually the more we've suppressed our emotions. So many of the younger persons, if they begin developing these skills, will start allowing hearing, the hearing of voices, or start allowing the writing of automatic writing or something like that, and might within in a few weeks dealing with a few emotions start actually channeling things. Whereas some of the others of us here who've never channeled may take months, or it may take even the whole year before you start receiving information. The key is to allow yourself to continue developing all of these things emotionally. Does that make sense, don't you? Now what we'll be doing is we'll be breaking our homework into sort of three stages generally, and then we'll have a debriefing stage after that. So the first stage of our homework is going to be like a pre-development stage. And what I mean by that is I will give you a task to do with regard to your mediumship, or if you're a healer, with regard to your healing, that you need to try as soon as you can after you've left the group. Does that make sense? So let's say you decide, we'll give you one shortly for the next two sessions, for the next month. Let's say you decide that you'll do it Monday or Tuesday this week. So you do it Monday or Tuesday this week, write it down, and then you'll go through a period. I'll make a suggestion of the development phase, which is developing yourself in a certain direction and seeing what the results are going to be after you've developed. Does that make sense? So what we'll be doing, and I'll probably just note this up for you, but it's in the notes that you've been emailed. You'll have a pre-development. Homework. So that's the homework you do before you start changing yourself emotionally. Then there'll be a suggestion made to you in terms of your development. By the way, you don't have to do any of these things. It's totally up to you. Like, I'm not going to come around and visit you when my sleep state and give you a whack over the head and say, you're not coming to another session. Right? It's not going to be like that. It's up to you what you do. The development will be as suggestions that I'll be giving to you to help you through the process of development. And then there'll be a post-development sort of homework. So what that means is just before you come to the next session, do the post-development homework. So let's say the pre-development stuff might happen next week. I might make a suggestion to channel or attempt to channel a certain message. And by the way, it doesn't matter if you get nothing. It's just a matter of attempting these things, then do the development and then do a post-development thing. And that would be done just before the next mediumship session, so the week before the next mediumship session. So if you sort of plan it out in your mind, sort of like allow a week to do that, 2 weeks to do this, or maybe a bit longer, and a week to do that, because it would depend a little too on how you feel in terms of clarity, how you're feeling about yourself, and a lot of things as to whether you're going to have the clarity to be able to do it. And then come along to the next group. Now, in each group from now on, what we'll be doing is having a session which I would call like a debrief, where those people who wish to can come and sit in the hot seat and they'll show me their pre-development, whatever it is, mediumship or notes that if they're making that to do with healing. They'll talk to the audience about, you know, some of the things they noticed. These will be short things, by the way. I'll be limiting these things to half a page, right, in each case, because obviously if we make them too big, then most of us are not going to get to do it. So we want to try and keep it quite short. So half a page, half a page. We talk about that, and what I will then do is talk about the emotions that have caused the messages to be distorted inside the person. So that's going to be very confronting for many of you, because many of you won't even feel those emotions in you, let alone think that they've affected you. Many of you will believe that, or want to believe that, in fact, how you channeled the message is exactly how you received it, when in reality you'll find that's not the case. Now, perhaps I'm thinking, if I could use what I've been doing with you, James, as an example, what we might do is just fire up another mic, and perhaps not read all of the first, but just read the sections that I've actually went through with you and said, now this emotion has affected this particular thing. So if I can give you an example, what's happened with myself and James is that James has wanted to develop his mediumship for some time. So what he did was he came to me and said, look, you know, I want to develop the mediumship, what do I do? And so he started just receiving messages, and what I did then was sat down with him and went through the message and told him how his emotion affected that particular part of the message. And then he then went back to his spirit guide asking for clarification whether what I was saying was correct or not. Does that make sense? And in this way, he could actually work out quite rapidly what emotions were affecting what things. And so what I would like to do maybe is just give you an example of a few of those things, and I'll get this mic set up. And
if I can get through this, because it's... If I can get through this, it's got a lot of emotional impact for me. Okay. As AJ said, he got me to go to my guide and ask for information about my present condition and things I needed to deal with. And I went and asked specifically about my hearing problems. I've got deafness, I wear hearing aids in both ears. And my guide said that this began very early in my life, and it progressed steadily since then, and said that when I was very young, there were many things that my mother said to me which threatened my peace and security, and that I perceived them to be untrue, and I began to close down because I didn't want to hear this anymore, and that increased the grief that I was already feeling. As I closed down more, I also closed down all the grief that I had inside me. That I sure know I was there. And in my early life, I was very open to spirit communication, and this caused a lot of conflict between what I was told by spirit and what I was told by my mother, that the two disagreed. And it led to a serious conflict within me, as I didn't know who or what to believe. And when I was able to speak, I repeated information received from spirit, and my mother rejected this. And I felt totally rejected. And it led me to doubt almost everything I was told, not just from my mother, but from spirit as well too. And I began to retreat a lot from human contact and spent a lot of my young years out of my body. And also, I stopped asking questions. And that's something that persists in my life today. I try to intuit what's going on with other people, what's going on in the situations, and I don't ask questions. And my guide says to me almost on a daily basis, ask questions, ask more questions. Then he said this was reinforced by my mother's demands that I know how she felt all the time. She denied much of her feelings. And so I would know how she was feeling, but she'd tell me that wasn't it. And so I began to doubt even more my senses and what I was picking up. And I then became terribly afraid of being wrong and being rejected. And this led me into the snag that AJ was talking about before. That was me. And this led me to a feeling of being wrong and rejected. And I developed the belief that it was necessary for me to please any woman with whom I had dealings or risk rejection, while at the same time I also believed that all women were deceivers. So I couldn't trust them but had to please them anyway. And the wider implication of this, that I was unable to trust the feminine side of myself, and I was then obliged to repress my intuition and creativity, which included music and artistic expression of any sort. And he said, you actually have considerable artistic talent that remains untapped today. And repressing these aspects of yourself, which are dominant abilities, threw you onto relying on the masculine aspects of your being, which are the areas where you have least confidence and less ability. And this has led to you to living your life in a sort of no man's land of repression and unfulfilled desire and undeveloped abilities. Indeed, undeveloped genius. And some of this you've sensed for some time, but haven't known what to do about it, or whether anything could be done. And that I'm aware that I have a tendency to give up when the going gets tough.
Now, can I just comment a little about what he's just read out? You notice that as he's been working through and is saying these things to you, James is now starting to connect to some of the emotion that Francis, who is his guide, has been trying to connecting with. And now, when James first read this message out to me, one thing I noticed when James was reading it was that he wasn't emotionally connected to what he was saying in that paragraph at all. Right? He was just reading it as if it was just information about somebody else. And now he's starting to read it as if it's information about himself, which of course it is. And so there was times in the channeling where, because what was the time of the day that you did this channeling? Did you note that down?
Yeah, I did. No, I didn't on this one. It was late in the morning.
Yeah.
Early afternoon, maybe.
So you were quite rested on the day off.
Yeah.
So James did this channeling on a day off, quite rested, and it was a very, very good channeling. This particular channeling, there was only a few errors that I found into it that where Francis would have chosen a different word here and there rather than the words that James chose, which I actually highlighted to him and then he confirmed with Francis. But because James was in this nice open state emotionally, he could receive a lot of really good information about his own emotional condition, which you could even connect to more, if that nothing else. Because every time James now reads it, he feels like crying but doesn't let himself do that.
This process offers a great opportunity to develop and test your abilities, and we welcome the opportunity to participate. We were listening while Jesus spoke with you and sensed both your excitement and your level of commitment to this process. For best results, it will be well for you to be in a rested state with as clear a mind as you can. You should take care with what you eat and drink and avoid stimulants and alcohol. Also avoid heavy foods and avoid too much food, as these will slow your system. Setting regular times is less necessary and not a great idea. It's more important that you be in a good frame of mind and body. And then he said we can begin with the personal information regarding the emotional issues, underlying problems that you have, and tackle other items as appropriate.
Now, in that paragraph, which was a very accurate paragraph, right at the beginning of the paragraph, James wrote that Francis said to develop and test his abilities. But actually, when I was feeling Francis, he didn't want to use the word test your abilities. He wanted to use the word develop your abilities. And this came from an emotion within James, where he's always testing himself. He's always trying to prove himself. Does that make sense? And because he's always trying to prove himself, he then assumes that and substitutes for the word develop the word test. And of course they are two different words, aren't they, that have a lot of different meanings. One sort of is like a test that you might go in to get a grade from. The other is like just developing ability. So can you see how just... Now, this was a very good channeling because James was very open emotionally during it. But even open emotionally, just that one emotion of having to test himself puts an inflection on a paragraph that wasn't intended by his guide at all. Do you see the relationship with what's going on there? Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. So, thanks. So what we want to do in these sessions is not to test your abilities, but rather develop them. But in the process of developing them, what we'll be doing is confronting the emotions that cause these inflections to creep into anything that you receive. Now, the same applies very much with regard to healing. Healing has the same restrictions in that when we're healing, it's the spirit attraction based on our own soul condition that draws certain spirits to us to assist in the process. And it's also the spirits of the person we're healing that actually draws to them people of a certain condition as well who want to interact with them. And I wanted to give you a few examples on a healing side of how this can be a very, very different experience than what people think it is. In Adelaide, they have this fair, it's called a psychic fair. You have one here in Brisbane too, every year, right? And I find them quite fascinating events because there are spirits usually there of all sorts of variety of conditions, and a lot of them in quite poor condition visiting these locations. And there's usually these booths where people are healing people, doing spiritual healing for 10, 15 minutes at a time. And I went to this one particular booth and I just sat back on a chair that was there outside of it and just watched the interactions that were going on with the people and the spirits and the people that were being healed, if I could use the term loosely. And what I found in many cases was that there were altogether, I think there were about 7 or 8 healers, and 3 of the healers were men. And in every single case, these men were not healing their women subjects. They were actually having sexual interactions with their women subjects. Now, the women would come away feeling a bit sexually turned on and feeling like something shifted within themselves. In reality, what had happened was the spirits with them and the men themselves were in this state where they were actually interacting with them sexually on an energetic level. And they were going away thinking they were being healed. Right? So obviously, if you walked into a place like that and you were clear of your emotions, you would feel that instantly, wouldn't you? You'd feel, there's a sexual interaction happening here. Actually, I don't want to be healed by you. You need to go and be healed. And you would feel that particular interaction happening. Does that make sense? But if you're not clear emotionally, you would sit there and the law of attraction would bring you this event and you'd come away maybe feeling a bit sleazy or feeling like a bit upset, and it's the law of attraction that's brought those events to you. And in those particular instances, you'll see lots and lots of law of attraction in these events.
In this last week, I'm feeling like I want to become anonymous, and for the last 10 or 15 minutes, I've been seeing the sick burning up, and I asked all side of me what's happening, and my brain's feeling fine, and business feeling fine. Mm. So I've looked, and but they choose to feel anonymous. They choose to be anonymous. Mm-hmm. And I show who they are, that I'm literally burning up with, and I'm like, that's the way that I sense that connection's
been made. Yeah, so now what you would need to do is go that one step further and say, all right, I want anonymity. There's something in this emotionally for me. What happens when I'm exposed? And if you look at your posting just recently on the net where you were exposed, what happens?
It's intensely fearful.
Exactly.
I'm feeling deep, deep, deep. fear.
Yeah. And so these spirits are attracted to you through that law of attraction of that fear, the fear of exposure, the fear of being outed, the fear of, you know, everyone seeing who you truly are. And that's the emotion you need to work through. And so you'll find these interactions happening all the time, right? So the key is, as your law of attraction changes, so will the spirits with you change, and so will what happens in that interaction change. The key is for you to be ready for that. Just like you're ready for it in your day-to-day life, to be ready for it in these spirit interactions.
So will you see spirits who might not be of your soul condition, say past, just the ones that will gather around you, maybe wandering around the same condition?
You will see spirits of all sorts of soul conditions. Right? Now, the higher the spirit, the more difficult it is both to see them and to know what their condition is. For example, it's very, very difficult for any of you to know what a celestial spirit's condition feels like. The reason why is none of you are celestial spirits yet. I'll say yet because you will be at some time, right? When you can feel that state, then you'll know what that condition feels like. Does that make sense? And you'll know that a person coming to you is a celestial spirit for certain, because you can feel that state in them. But, so can you see, if I'm in a state of the first fear when I start this, so if I just draw it from a sort of more of a... So here I am. I'm progressing in love, right? 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, so forth. Celestial spirit starts at the 8th sphere. Now, if I start this process and I'm in the first sphere, who am I easily going to see is in the same state as me? Just someone in the first sphere, right? That's all. Will I notice the person in the second sphere as well? No. And the third sphere, it'll be so above my condition that I won't even be able to tell really what they're feeling. And aside from their transmission of love to me, I won't even be able to properly tell them what their emotion is, because my own emotion is in a worse condition. Does that make sense? So it's going to be very dependent on your own emotional condition as to who you attract and what happens with that. You follow me?
Do you need to know who you are?
No, that's the beauty of this. In fact, I encourage everyone to not bother about knowing where they are, but look at their law of attraction. So if you're attracting some suicidal spirits in your life as soon as you start opening up, then there's a high likelihood I've got some kind of suicidal feelings within me, or I've got some feelings that suicide is okay, or I've got something to be triggered here, you know, inside of me. If I'm attracting a lot of angry men spirits and I'm a woman, I must have a sympathetic emotion where I'm letting men who are angry interact with me. So there must be a emotion in me where I'm willing to be abused by angry men, whether I know it or not. I'm obviously willing for that to occur. Does that make sense? Allow yourself to feel these attractions. Now, rather than answer too many more questions, I want to present some more material, and I've only got about 40 so minutes or so to do it. Now, what I would like to do is firstly introduce homework periods for you, if you like, over the coming month. Now, the first one is about the subject, the hierarchy, hierarchy. of truths. Now, we presented this in the spirit communication sessions a month or two ago. What I mean by the hierarchy of truths is that there are lower truths, and there are more higher truths, and higher truths, and higher truths, and then there's the highest possible truths you can receive. Now, the highest possible truths you can receive are about divine love and divine truth. The lowest possible truths you can receive will all be about physical things. You know, like, where'd Mum left the keys today? You know, oh, they're on the shelf over in the corner there. You can get messages like that from spirits too, right? And they will be the lowest truths that you will be able to receive. Now, I should put truths in quotations, because in the lowest truths, there is often a lot of falsehood. In the lowest truths, there is often a lot of falsehood. There is a lot of error. In other words, I could be hearing a truth that the spirit who is talking to me believes is the truth, but is actually an error. So it's like someone on earth being totally convinced they know the truth about a subject, and yet they don't know the truth about that subject. And that person talking to you. Then even lower than that will be spirits who are in error, enjoying themselves. And I use the term enjoyment very loosely. In other words, they come to you because they can have some fun with you. And because you might be trusting, or you might be, you know, open to receiving truths from the spirit world, they present things to you. Now, there's a lady in Arizona who contacted me a few years ago. She said, I've got the angel Gabriel and the apostle Peter talking to me, and they're saying to me that everything you're saying to me is not right. I said, okay, no worries. And she said, you know, I believe in reincarnation, and I believe in this teaching and that teaching. A lot of New Age teachings she was teaching. She had a couple of websites that she was posting these messages on. The thing that confronted her was I was saying there was no past lives to regress, because she was a person who was doing past life regressions. And she was saying, her two spirit guides were saying, yes, there is. So what's going on? Well, the first thing I did, I said, well, firstly, I would like you to try an experiment. What I would like you to do is to channel from these spirits what they think about me. And I would encourage them to be really open and honest about what they think about me. Then I would like them to do some things, if they would agree, to do some things. I felt that they were sincere spirits. And I said, I would like them to do some things. And then come back and channel again what they think about me after they've done those things. And for you to be in a good state in hearing both channelings. Now, this lady had been channeling for lots and lots of years, so she found this pretty easy task. She said she found it difficult to perform because she thought I would be upset about what they really felt about me. Anyway, they said that I was probably deluded. I was very highly likely quite crazy. And they made a number of other inferences about that. But I had a loving intention. That's what they said about me, in a nutshell. And I said, no worries. Okay, now what I'd like to invite them to do was, I've got some spirit friends that are in the celestial spheres who will come to them, and those celestial spirits over a period of a couple of days will show them some truths that they don't know about yet. And this lady's going, no, this is the angel Gabriel I'm talking to, and the apostle Peter. There's not going to be much these spirits are going to be able to show them. This is her feelings, right? The spirits, of course, know they're not the angel Gabriel and the apostle Peter, right? Which is an issue we'll address in a minute. So anyway, they go away, they do some experiments, they come back, different channeling this time. You are not deluded, is the different channeling. We found out that you're not deluded, and in fact, we found out that all of the things you've been teaching for 2,000 years, we're now starting to understand. So that was the channeling after she did those experiments. Now, the lady's condition hadn't changed. Only the spirits with her condition had changed. And because the lady didn't believe anything about who I was saying I was either, of course. Now, in the process of those two channelings, we started to address the issue of whether they were the angel Gabriel and the apostle Peter. And I said to her, well, I'm sorry, but they aren't. And I said, now, what I would like you to do is ask them whether they are. And she asked them, and they said, no, we're not. And then, of course, what's the next question? Why did you let me believe that you are? Well, why would you let somebody believe you're something that you're not?
Help you teach higher truths, perhaps, if it's a good intention.
Yeah, if it's a good intention, you say, She believes it, and I'm connecting her to her real world now. We don't want to muddy the waters and tell her that we're not the person. So they didn't. Now, that automatically tells you also what path they were on. They're on the natural love path in the spirit world. Because a divine love spirit wouldn't do that. A divine love spirit on any section of after receiving divine love generally and knowing about it would not falsify the truth about who they are to the other person, to the person on earth. So we then started working through this lays and motions about being hoodwinked for many years of her life by these spirits.
Why did they lie?
Well, they didn't lie. Their reasoning was they didn't lie. Their reasoning was that all they did was they didn't tell her the truth. You've done the same thing in your life, so don't tell me you haven't, right?
Yes.
Okay. So they just did the same thing as what you've done many times. So they just let the person believe the lie because they could. And the person, the lady, did not have the emotional development to know they were lying or to know that they weren't telling the truth. She was just trusting everything, of course, coming to her. Now, of course, she went through many, many dark emotions about that. And I was trying to encourage her, don't give up this relationship with them. You know, they've been your friends, and I just call them her friends. They've been your friends for many years. They've given you a lot of really good information, a lot of good information about emotions, even though it was about past life emotions. They were really, all the emotional stuff was very accurate. They were just using the past life stuff, which now, by the way, these spirits were saying to her, they don't believe in anymore. So these spirits, in just a few weeks of time, went from teaching her past life regression, teaching her about past life information, teaching her about reincarnation, teaching every single person they channeled about all of those things, to not doing that. Now, how would you feel? You've posted all this stuff on the internet. Like, that's pretty confronting, isn't it, to you as the medium, getting into this point of actually saying, I've posted all this stuff on the net, and lo and behold, most of it's false. What am I going to do now? What do? Do I say to everyone, oh, by the way, the angel Gabriel that I've been channeling is not the angel Gabriel anymore, and the apostle Peter I've been channeling is not the apostle Peter, and by the way, a lot of the information that I've been channeling is actually not correct. Like, now, that's going to take a lot of bravery, isn't it? And so this lady just couldn't cope with that. She couldn't cope with the thought of that. And so what she decided to do was to just close down her websites and say that she's had some major emotional shifts that she can't explain, and she didn't want to be open about what they were. Now, I was trying to encourage her, be open. You know, the people that are still attracted to you will be attracted to that truth, you know, that you're now telling. These two spirits are now on the divine love path. They're going to be able to help connect with you with lots and lots of truths. And she was saying, no, but I can't trust them anymore. They lied to me. I can't. And that's an emotion, isn't it? An emotion of, like, I can't trust. So that's another emotion to deal with. And can you see how, if I was a medium on the divine love path, I would be able to work through all of those emotions and stay in contact with those spirits? If those spirits particularly were progressing. But if I'm a medium on the natural love path who is very, very interested in my own, like how everyone perceives me, and I don't want to deal with that emotionally, you can just see how I might react totally differently to that. And so that was very, very confronting for this lady. And as far as I'm aware, I haven't heard from her now for nearly 2 years. And I haven't seen her website start up again either. So that was a really huge faith thing that went for her. She feels now like she can't trust anybody.
How did the celestial spirits communicate those truths with those spirits so quickly and so profoundly? Did they do it through?
Well, it's a bit off topic, but basically it's a soul-to-soul interaction. What a celestial spirit can do is give you packet information. It's very, very similar to how, in fact, our internet network works and so forth. What happens is there's packets of information that flow from one location to another, and a celestial spirit can actually project rapidly, and I'm saying beyond the speeds of what we're capable of assimilating here on Earth through our brain.
Like a download.
Like a download to another spirit. And actually they can take them, and this is what happened in these two spirits. These celestial spirits took the spirits to the next higher sphere than where they existed. And you can loan the energy and the love condition, you can loan love if you like, as a spirit, you can loan your energy and love to a spirit in lower condition to temporarily show them something that you couldn't normally show them. Right? And so this happens all the time in the spirit world, to teach people if they want to learn. And so these two spirits wanted to learn, and so they got taught in that manner. So the spirits are fine, they're on this, you know, they're progressing now on the divine love path, but unfortunately the woman who was connecting with them doesn't feel like she can connect with them anymore, which I feel is quite sad. But the opportunity was there was to retain the connection, but to retain the connection would require a lot of humility, wouldn't it? You'd have to be humble to the fact that you've been channeling stuff that wasn't true. You'd have to then tell the people who you were channeling to, well, actually, there is no past life regression, but the emotional part of what I said is true. And you'd have to maybe rechannel some of those messages. There'd be a lot of work in that. Can you see how, like, it would finish up triggering the person quite a lot? And in the case of this lady, that's what happened. And so she found it quite difficult. So this is what we face with the hierarchy of truths. We face the fact that there are spirits in really, really fantastic condition who want to transmit divine truth to you. And then there's spirits in really, really dark condition who want to transmit and have fun with you and transmit lots of error so your life gets into a mess with you. And then there's all these spirits in between. And what's going to depend on who you talk to? Your soul condition. So what we're going to do is two exercises. An exercise on the hierarchy of truths and an exercise on your soul condition. Now I've outlined these exercises, so they'll be on an email. The hierarchy of truth exercise is going to be about the law of attraction. Is everyone on the email who have come to the session? If you're not, is it possible to maybe create a list for you, James? I think most of you by now probably be on email, but if you're not, so that you can get this so that I don't have to read it out. On the soul condition thing, remember it is my soul condition that attracts spirits as well as people on earth. In fact, your soul condition is what attracts everything. And do you remember what your soul condition was? It's the sum total of every single thing within you emotionally. All of your belief systems. All of your emotions. All of your passions. All of your desires. It even includes things like your intellectual beliefs and how that may interfere. All of these things are all part of what happens at the soul condition level and how you communicate. They all govern the law of rapport. So, if I'm in the condition that I'm unaware of, then I'm going to attract certain types of messages that if I was in a different condition, I would not attract. And in fact, the way celestial spirits communicate with me is via my soul, not via my hearing. So spirits on the natural love path will communicate usually via your hearing or via the spirit body senses. Whereas spirits on the divine love path will communicate, and in the celestial spheres will communicate soul to soul with you. Now the problem with the communication soul to soul is if you're not in the same soul condition as the person communicating to you, you're going to interpret many of the communications not the way they intended. Does that make sense?
So does that mean they perhaps could give you a packet of information as well?
Yes, they'll be able to give you a packet of information which you will then just write, you know, this is what came to me. But it will be through your emotional filter. It'll be through whatever emotions you are yet to have developed within yourself.
I feel I received a packet of information when shared about resistance. And what has felt for
you you received packeted information on a number of occasions. That is one of them. On another occasions when you channeled about soulmates, you received packet information. Yeah.
And I felt like as my soul condition has improved, more of that information it's light, remembered, but it's different.
Exactly. You feel everything as truth when it's packet information, but it still comes through your soul condition. So
what I was trying to point out is that it's like a transition. It's like, as I felt my law of attraction change and therefore thought that my soul condition was perhaps improving,
yep.
I'm not even going on my own. More of the information comes to a realization, and it matches with what you're saying about.
But what's happening with yourself, Jen, is that and this is something that all of you will need to be aware of too, is that the day you're feeling an emotion, a different thing will occur. So what's happened one time is you sometimes when you start feeling about the Mormon spirits around you, you get into a different condition. And then those Mormon spirits communicate things that are out of harmony with divine truth to you, which you're then having a tendency to believe. Does that make sense? And then
sometimes they take
control of you, it feels like.
And I said last time I spoke to you, sometimes when I speak, I don't even know.
Exactly.
It's not me speaking.
And that's because you're a very clear medium, and you're so used to channeling anything from anyone. And what the particular part of your thing you're going to need to develop is knowing who's speaking what through you. So, you know, when the angry spirits come and yell and scream and Graham and swear at him and curse him, well, that's a whole different group of spirits, again, who are in this space. So you have a range of spirits connecting to you, depending on what emotion you're in that particular moment. And this will happen to every one of you. In the particular moment, there will be a different condition which will attract different spirits. So you can't assume that every condition, I'm going to always attract the same spirit, or that every condition, that any condition I'm in will result in me attracting a spirit who will be able to tell me a certain truth, because it's going to be very dependent upon the emotions that I'm feeling at that particular time.
It's a shocking responsibility, because I don't speak, and now I'm realising I don't know whether that's me. Yet it's a huge responsibility, like the lady at the website, that I must, you know, I feel my soul says repent of this.
Yep.
If I've gone and said something that really believed was me,
yep.
But it wasn't actually me.
The big emotion that's affecting this for you is this. Because you have a need or a desire to be heard all the time, any spirit can just talk through you without there being any interference of the information they're giving through you. Whereas if you got rid of that emotion, like by dealing with that emotionally, working your way through that emotion completely at the causal level, you'll find you'll be able to feel, oh, this is a spirit actually, I don't think I want to repeat what he wants to say, because he wants to say some real nasty things to Graham, you know what I mean? And look at your law of attraction. But it's the need to be heard that just allows you to just speak up in every single situation and every single thing that you hear. And it's that emotion that you need to allow yourself to deal with. Does that make sense? So in every single case that we'll be going through later when we debrief, because debriefing is going to be one of these processes where we work through what emotion is driving you, I'll be saying things like I've just said to Jen. This need to be heard is creating this problem for you. This other emotion, this anger with men, is creating this problem for you. This other emotion where you're upset about, you know, the fact that you weren't noticed is creating this problem for you with regard to spirits and so forth. And every one of those things will influence what happens with this mediumship.
How would you do it? Where would you start?
What I would do is every time I had a desire to speak, I would actually put my hand over my mouth and go into the emotion of what's the feeling if I don't speak? What am I going to feel if I don't speak? Because speaking is the addiction. So when a person needs to be heard, the next thing they're going to do, they're going to be addicted to, is speaking. Right? So I'm going to, if I have a need to be heard, I'm going to want to speak. I'm going to want to make sure people understand me. I'm going to believe they don't understand me and I need to speak more. Does that make sense? So if I hold on,
right,
and just allow myself to connect to the emotion that's driving it, you'll feel a real panic sensation perhaps even come up. And in fact, in your case, Jen, it's related to the event just after the man kidnapped you and you walked out of the room, that you understand why it's related to that? When you walked out, yeah, so you're connecting to that emotionally now. So when you walked out and you were yelling and screaming about what had happened to you, what was happening? Because it was the end of the horse race and everyone was yelling and screaming and watching the horse race, nobody hearing you. And that's the causal emotion, right? And there'll be other emotions related to that after that event, but that's a real basic causal emotion. Does that make sense?
It sounds like a basic principle or technique, if you want. If you find that you having a need to do something or a pattern that's happening,
yep.
to actually suppress that and look at what comes up when you're not doing it.
Yeah, look, because every one of those needs are addictions. So how many of you feel addicted to chocolate at period time? Are you ladies? Not period. No men in this question. Quite a few. How many men and women are addicted to chocolate? All the time. My thing was ice cream. I just, you know, I was addicted to it. Take away the ice cream, lots of emotions come up.
With that lady with the website, who was saying that she had the opportunity to continue working with the celestial spirits.
Well, no, they weren't celestial spirits. They were spirits who she was connecting with earlier, but they were now on the divine love path. She had the opportunity to stay communicating with them because she had a fantastic rapport with them that had been developed over years. Yes. Her knee condition needs to improve. And so what she would need to do. Yeah. And the law of attraction was bringing her each of these opportunities that she was suppressing. She opted out of those opportunities, which actually would have helped her grow her spiritual development to the point where she could continue to hear these spirits. And of course, if she listened to them even, because she had a very good hearing of them in terms of hearing, spirit, because of the communication over the years, she could have just followed their direction. But because of the feeling of mistrust that she didn't want to feel, she chose a different path, which meant that those emotions never got dealt with. So I want to encourage you not to do that. I encourage you to allow yourself to work through these things emotionally. Now, the exercise with soul, I want to explain a little. And the reason why I want to explain it is because my Mary's been brave enough to actually put her hand up about something here. What I'm going to do in that exercise, and you'll see it outlined, is for you to channel a message about Mary's soul condition as it currently is on Earth. Not so. I would say that to clarify it, because as some celestial spirit, as celestial spirits already know, there is a very big difference between her condition as you see her now and her real condition, and there's reasons for that, which I won't go into at this point. But that's what we'll be doing in there. So we'll do it before the development that we suggested and after the development we've suggested. Okay? Now, the reason why I'm doing it that way is that very few of you know Mary really well. But I know her really well. So I can tell you what bits are accurate and what bits aren't quite easily. And whereas you won't know, so you're going to have to trust your connection. Can you see that? You're also probably going to get a bit freaked out with the whole thing, because you're commenting about my girl. And if you get it wrong, you know, who knows what might happen. But then again, like, you know, you might not know that Mary's, you know, she can get angry at times, you know. You never know what she might. You see, these are the emotions that will actually influence you. Can you see that? And this is one of the reasons why Mary suggested herself, is that in the process of doing this, a lot of these emotions of, oh, am I worthy to talk about her condition? You know, I don't believe she's Mary, so how about that? You know, I don't believe she's Mary Magdalene, so, you know, and there'll be all sorts of things that you feel. And I want you to channel them accurately. as you receive them. Does that make sense? And for those of you on the healing path, there's an exercise of telling me the spiritual condition based on your intuition, the spiritual condition of the spirit surrounding Mary. So those of you that are healers, that'll be the exercise. And it'll be very interesting for you, and Mary feels probably interesting for Mary. Very what?
Humbling.
Very humbling for Mary. Mary's very humble already, so I don't think she'll have too much trouble about that.
So the one who doesn't know Mary, do you just kind of look at her?
No. You are connecting to a spirit who is telling you Mary's emotions. So you don't even need to see Mary even. Does that make sense? It's the spirit who needs to see Mary. So for all the spirits that are helping you, they know who Mary is now. So they'll be able to connect and look at Mary. So Mary's getting examined as we speak about her emotional condition. And then they'll be able to channel to you what that condition is. Does that make sense? And then we'll be able to talk more about that. So,
are you expecting those of us who are beginners, raw beginners, still being able to channel anything?
You may not be able to. I'm not expecting anything, by the way. This is just here to help if you want assistance in doing these things. So I'm not expecting anything, but my suggestion is if you're open, just go with your intuition, because you'll find actually your intuition is one of the major connections with your spirit friends. So trust that intuition that you're getting. Now, you'll come along and maybe get debriefed, and I'll tell you that your intuition was just blown. Right? And what are you going to feel then? Hi, I trusted my intuition. He told me to trust it. And look what he's doing now. He's just saying that it was all useless. No, it wasn't useless. Because the whole point of this exercise is to identify the emotions that interfere. Do you follow me? Yeah. And that's the whole point of this exercise, is to look at the soul condition, which is the emotions that interfere. And the hierarchy of truths example is about the law of attraction. So these two things will be homework for the coming month. You follow me? To give them a go. Now, I've put an explanation of them in the handouts that we've given, so I don't need to give them to you now. So I just want to focus you maybe on one of them. If with every note that I put down in this session, I'll be putting down what the key point is. And the key point for soul condition is your soul condition determines all accuracy of mediumship and effectiveness of healing. So that's the key point. Then I put down notes about the key point. The soul condition is the controlling force governing. The soul's primary attribute is about love, so it's about your condition in love that's going to govern. It's also about moral condition. So if you have certain moral issues, that's going to change the kinds of message that you get. So I've got notes like that underneath that. These are things for you just to bear in mind in your learning. And then I have your homework. I've got, remember, the pre-development homework? So in this pre-development thing about mediumship with Mary's condition, what you'll do is channel a half a page about Mary's feelings, maybe next week, before you do any emotional development. Then do the emotional development, I suggest. So in this case, the emotional development is find a situation through the law of attraction that makes you annoyed, angry, or frustrated. So during the week, there's a situation that's going to come up for you, guaranteed, that will make you annoyed, angry, or frustrated. Because most of us have these emotions. The next thing, delve into the emotions of anger. So, in other words, start expressing the anger and rage, right? Bang, 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 baseball bat, hose on the pillow, or whatever it is that connects you emotionally. This is part of the exercise. And then go deeper and access the causal emotion. So what about that particular event made me feel this anger? And once I connect to that and dig in deeper, I'll find a heap of grief and a heap of sadness, and I'll start experiencing that sadness. So I'll have a big cry. And maybe a number of them. And you might cry for a week, in fact, with some of them. Right? Then after you've done that, channel Mary's emotional condition again. Does that make sense? Yep, that's written down. So what we're doing is we're doing a pre-development thing. We do some of the development, And then what we're attempting to do is measure the development that we've made. Can you see that? And what I will do with the ones who are willing to come up, I'll talk about the pre-development condition emotionally and why that particular emotion that they release caused them to see things differently afterwards, if there is any difference afterwards. And also we'll be talking about what condition, soul condition inside of them, caused them to not get certain things right about Mary's soul condition. Does that make sense? Now, the reason why this is so important is because in the end, many of you will be channeling to people to help them things about their own soul condition, about the emotions that are locked up within them that you can help them release just by saying the right words. Right? Now, if the spirit's trying to say the right words to you and you're getting it all mixed up and saying it the opposite to the person, that's not going to be very helpful to the person. So can you see how I need my soul condition in a nice clear state to be able to reflect that information? So that's what the point of all of these exercises. So those two exercises will help you see, firstly, the truth of these points of development, but they will also help you begin to measure your own progression as a healer or as a medium. And you'll be able to measure it as you go. Now, for many of you who are not yet mediums, or what I'm suggesting to you is trust your intuition, right? So many of you have never thought you've heard a spirit in your entire life, right? But the truth is, most of you have. In fact, all of you have at some point in your life. So there is, all you need to do is get into a place where trust your feelings for a moment. Just trust them. Now, when you come up and do the debriefing, you may find those feelings were all inaccurate. Don't get despondent about that. Still trust them. But also look at the emotions that caused them to be inaccurate. Does that make sense? So this will help through the process of identifying emotions and help unravel within you what limits your communication abilities and the abilities to receive truths. And the reason why it's so important to learn how to deal with other people's soul condition, and your own of course, is because that is where that is some of the highest truths you can ever give a person. So, you know, if you're a medium and the people come to you, you know, a lot of times they come to you, what's going to happen next week, what's going to happen next month, what about this new man that I met, and all those kind of things. And instead of giving them answers about all of that, your spirit's guide is going to be wanting to give them answers of, this is your soul condition, this is what your law of attraction is, this is why you've attracted this man into your life, this emotion is there, this is what you need to deal with. Now that's going to be really powerful for them in their life. But if they do it all physically or metaphysically, they'll create the same relationship again, the same thing again, all through their life, and nothing will change. So this is why it's such a powerful thing to learn. So that'll be the first two lessons. After these lessons, what I'll be doing is I'll be getting the whole summary of spirit communication discussion that we did 4 or 8 weeks ago or whatever it was. And what I'll be doing is going one by one, we'll be doing lessons of each of the things that affect your communication and each of the things that affect your ability to hear spirits and your ability to heal people. Now, at the bottom of the handout, I've listed 6 movies to see. Now, you don't have to do them all in one in the 4 weeks, right? They're all quite confronting movies about spirit communication. Although I don't know if I'd call Ghost confronting. But anyway. They're movies about spirit communication. There is also 3 books that I want to encourage you to read over the coming months. It's the Robert James Lee series of books that are on the CDs that you've had handed out. Through the Mist, The Life of Elysian, and The Gate of Heaven. And whenever you get to a point that talks about spirit interaction, take particular note of what's going on in those books with regard to spirit interaction. There's plenty of homework, right? Be busy now. Now, in the hierarchy of truths discussion, one thing that I'm going to encourage you to do there is, many of you are reading all sorts of books, right? You might have a book of fiction on your side panel before you go to bed. You might have this really interesting book about, like, mine in the toilet, you know, like, what's that?
Ah,
oh, don't. Ah, oh, don't, she says. screaming, squirting, and whatever. Anyway, it's a sex book. And then you might have a... And then you might have another book about, you know, you might be reading the Pageant Visitors. My suggestion is for a month, focus on reading either those three books that I've said, that if you find them hard going, focus on reading the Pageant Messages just for that month. In other words, what we're going to do for a month is get our thoughts and everything in line with divine truth. So every time we're thinking, all through the day, we're now thinking about divine truth stuff. So we're getting ourselves out of the mundane life thinking and into the thinking about higher truths. And what we want to do is notice how that changes the interaction that we have with spirits. Does that make sense? And what spirits are attracted to us. And that's one of, that's what the exercise with hierarchy of truths will be dealing with. Does everyone follow me, what the goal is? Okay. Now, if you're focused in your passion on healing, I'll give you a separate, there's a separate sort of pre-development and post-development exercise to do than if you are focused on mediumship.
What if you don't know which one?
Then if you want, do both. Or none.
Yeah, what's the difference?
And healing is more along the lines of, like, if you want to heal people with their physical ailments. So let's say a person comes to you with a headache and you want to heal that headache. Let's say a person comes with a soul condition of anger and you want to help them heal that. Like, and so that's about that. Whereas the mediumship side is about receiving communication from spirits through a number of different methods. Automatic writing is usually the one that spirits enjoy more than others. Does everyone know why that's the case? Automatic writing is the thing that spirits enjoy more than other things. It's to do with how the brain works and how the communication with the arm works, but it's also to do with the fact that they can go back and correct things, and because they've got a written record of something that happened prior. Does that make sense? So they love having a written record of what happened, then they can say, oh, you're in a better condition now. Can we go back to that message? Because I didn't want to say that, I wanted to say this. And I didn't want to say that, I wanted to say this. Does that make sense? And if you've got a written record, you can display these things. Now, what I want to do over the coming months and maybe a year or so is to actually show, you'll see, if you keep a record, like a book of your own development, you'll see yourself changing. And some of the messages you'll start to receive will be messages that will benefit lots of other people besides yourself. Yeah. All right? And what I would like to do, with your permission, is to, if you want to send them to me, I can actually post them, or we'll put them in a forum or something like that, or just send them out via email to everyone to read, right? So that you can see what's going on. So for instance, the one that you wrote, Jen, about soulmates, and you placed on the forum, I think that's a lovely message about soulmates. And with a few little tweaks here and there that I've made, it would make a lovely message to the forum. And the tweaks I've made are surrounding your feeling of anger that you have with men. And we'll just make a few tweaks about that, because that's where the influence was in the message. And then, or you can deal with the anger with men and write the message again, and we'll post that. So does that make sense? Like, and the key is to not worry about your own condition so much. In fact, that's one of the emotions that we're going to be confronting, is this thing of, that we often have is, I want other people to see me as a bit better than what I really see myself, or I always feel worse than what other people see me as, or we want to confront those emotions as well during this process. So hopefully, after doing all of that, we'll have a group, a core group of people who are really wanting to do mediumship and who are connected, dealing with their emotions on the divine love path permanently, without wanting to jump off it because they're too afraid or overwhelmed. Right? And then we have a core group of people who are wanting to do healing, like real core healing to do with emotions, helping people work through their emotions to heal at the soul level. And those people feeling really, really comfortable and confident about helping others. And if we've got that core group of people on both of those sides, can you imagine what happens to the next group of people who come along to learn about the divine truth? They're going to have all of these helpers who can help them face up to their emotional condition, face up to their spiritual condition, face up to their physical body, material body, and spirit body, and their soul condition, and work through their emotions much more rapidly than what we've had to do, which just speeds up the entire process. Can you see that? And on top of that, because we're having mediumship sessions, we can help thousands and thousands and thousands of spirits in the lower spheres of the spirit world progress rapidly through their emotional condition. Because if I am sensitive to their emotion, I can help them now work through their emotion, because I have love for their condition. And I can help them work through their emotion and then connect them with celestial spirits who can assist them through their progress. And now those spirits who were maybe earthbound before affecting people on earth are now not affecting them at all. Now that has a beautiful lightening effect, you know, a lighting of the load effect of emotionally on all of us here. So instead of, you know, when we're crying, dealing with our anger with women, instead of having 100 men around us all angry with women, most of them are already gone. So now we're just dealing with our own emotion instead of dealing with lots and lots of other men's emotion at the same time, which obviously makes it a lot less complicated than if we're dealing with the projections as well. Does that make sense? So we can have this huge effect on people on earth just by shifting people in the spirit world to new locations and helping them move. And your ability when you grow as a medium will grow. You'll grow in that ability as well. Yes, there is. Of course, if I deny my emotions, and this is something that I'd like to just speak about perhaps for the next 5 minutes. If I deny my emotions, any denied emotion that I have within me, a spirit who is in a negative condition, or a malevolent spirit, I would call them, a spirit who maybe is a bit on the evil side, can abuse that emotion. So let's say inside of me, I have an emotion that I would really like to get glory for what I'm doing. So that's the emotion. So the emotion is this need for glory. Now, what do you reckon about all these spirits who have passed on earth and they had big, you know, big jobs and big houses and, you know, they were leaders of business or commerce or whatever, but they've, you know, raped economically thousands of people to do it. What do you reckon their condition would be? Pretty low, wouldn't it? In the first sphere, low conditions. What do they need? The same thing. They want glory. They want to feel powerful again. Right? So if I have a need for power, I'm going to attract some of those spirits. In particular, if I have a need for economic power or monetary power, I'm going to attract these spirits, right? Now, if I don't recognize that emotion within me and feel what the cause is within me, they are going to abuse that emotion in me for their own gain. And that's the issue you face. So yes, many of you after this discussion today may say, I'm having enough trouble dealing with my own emotions, let alone spirits being attracted with me with the same emotion. I think I might just hold off of the mediumship for a bit, right? Many of you may decide to do that. It's up to you. But understand, yes, there is this risk that if you choose during this process to deny an emotion within yourself, that emotion will be manipulated by spirits in a negative condition. They'll be attracted to you. And they will manipulate that emotion in you. So let's say you might have just a need for sex, right? And you're single, right? And you haven't dealt with the underlying emotion within you that causes you to have this need to connect with people sexually. What do you think you're going to attract? You're going to attract spirits who are needing to do the same thing because they're having the same problem, and they are going to manipulate you through that method, they'll cause certain things to happen in your life that cause you to get actually worsen your condition if you're not careful. Now I could list again lots of different things, about what might happen with your own condition. So if I have a need to please, lots of us have got that emotion, right? Right? I might be addicted to the emotions I get when I please somebody. So you know what that's going to do? That's going to be confronted by a truth, isn't it? Because how many of you don't want to say the truth if you know it's going to disappoint somebody? Huh? Lots of us. So if I have a need to please, the Spirit will say, oh yeah, this need to please. Interesting, hey? Oh, I can use that, you know. I can use that to my own benefit. Let's say I have a need for alcohol. Alcohol. Is that right? And if I have a need in me, obviously it's driven by an emotion. There's an emotional drive for everything that's needed within me. But if I have a need for it, who am I going to connect to? Some spirits who have the same need. And if I open myself up to these spirits, I might find myself drinking a bit more than usual. And then I might find myself getting in front a bit more than usual. And sometimes I might find myself getting drunk a bit more than usual, and actually getting drunk to the point where I can't even remember what I was doing anymore, a bit more than usual. Right? And then I'll have to realise that, yes, that's the law of attraction, that's the emotion I need to deal with.
Okay? Isn't it already true that the spirits are interacting with us?
Yes.
Whether we identify these needs and emotions,
yes,
we're already having a huge impact.
Yes. But if I open up more to the spirit communication, and I don't want to deal with the emotion, there's a likelihood it will happen more. So the proviso is, with all of this development, deal with your emotions. Right? Because if you choose not to, you're just going to get more heavily manipulated with this experiment that we're doing. Now, I feel there's nothing to be afraid of, because I feel like I want to deal with all my emotions. Right? And if you have that same attitude, then you will have nothing to be afraid of here. You'll work through the law of attraction, that everything will be exposed just right for you to deal with your emotions. But if you're afraid of dealing with your emotions, or you want to deny your emotions and want to make out that you don't have certain emotions, you want to make out that you're in better condition than you really are, or whatever, what's going to happen is that you'll be denying emotions within you, and that will be what they can use to manipulate you. Which, by the way, most of them are probably already doing. But if you open yourself even more to it, then obviously you'll be open more to their influence.
Well, you only attract your thing about being bombarded with all these emotions, undeveloped emotions, at a more intense level.
Mm-hmm.
So we can actually ask God for assistance.
Yeah, but see, my feelings are... Well, no. See, my feelings are, I want to deal with my emotions the most rapidly as I can. If you're asking God for assistance to slow down your own emotional progress, do you think that prayer is in harmony with God? What does God want you to do? Deal with your emotions. You're saying to Him, I want you to help me slow down the process. Do you think that prayer is in harmony with God?